Gildan Media presents an unabridged recording of Experiencing Spirituality, Finding Meaning Through Storytelling by Ernest Kurtz and Katherine Ketcham. Narrated by Sean Pratt and Shannon Parks. The following dedication appears in the book. Gratefully, we dedicate this book to and acknowledge the contributions of all who have taught us over the years, formal teachers and professors, diverse writers, good friends, many in the rooms, all those whose quiet example of dedication to truth helped us to experience spirituality. Introduction. What are you doing for an encore? So ran an occasional conversation starter from friends after the 1992 publication of our book, The Spirituality of Imperfection. Back to reading and thinking, came our usual answer. But then something new arrived in our lives. Even as the internet was dawning, at the very beginning of email, individuals began to contact us offering more or slightly different stories, some of which appear in this book. What? A gift. Eventually, as we read and listened to those gifts, this book began to take shape. But only barely, and very slowly, for our other reading, thinking, and life adventures combined with the stories, old and new, to lead us down diverse pathways pondering what we were experiencing. In our non-writing lives, meanwhile, Kathy was raising three children into and through the adventurous teen years, and Ernie confronted a cascade of body part replacement and other surgical events that led to his retirement from mainline academia. In contact through those years, despite the some 2,200 miles that separate us, we continued to exchange discoveries and insights. Slowly, the themes that make up this book emerged, hammered out on the hard anvil of our life experience, at least as much as in the soft tissue of our brains. Once upon a time, we had dared to write a book on spirituality, but now, 2 decades later, had we learned any more from our own experience trying to live that spirituality? We hope so. We think so. The governor resigned his exalted office and came to the master demanding to be taught. "What is it you wish me to teach you?" asked the master. "Wisdom," was the reply. Oh, my friend, how gladly would I do that were it not for one major obstacle. What? Wisdom cannot be taught. So there's nothing I can learn here? Wisdom can be learned, but it cannot be taught. And so the first truth with which we had to become comfortable was that anything we wrote would do no good, at least not directly. Once again, we turned to experience, both our own ongoing experiences over the intervening 20 years and the experiences captured and encapsulated in the traditions we had mined for the stories that conveyed the themes of a spirituality of imperfection. Because it is impossible directly to transmit or convey experience, for experience itself attests that it must be experienced, we again turned to stories. Experience is best awakened within story. Many of these stories and themes are light, even humorous, but some are dark, perhaps uncomfortable. Both experiences, after all, fall within the experience of most of us. As we reviewed those themes and the comments we had received, one question repeatedly struck us. Why is it that the most profound truths seem to be simplistic, even clichés? Probably, the stories seem to say, because through much experience, those who came before us discovered many of the most important truths about being humanly, and having learned them, they did try to pass them on. A word about being, which we spell B-E-ing. How irritating! Don't they know better than to put a stupid hyphen in the middle of an ordinary word? Yes, we do. But how, then, are we to convey in our language, as it is ordinarily used, the phenomenon of is-ness, the practice of is-ing. How do you be is not an inquiry into one's health. It's an honest question into how we conduct our daily life. This question might also be expressed by the more purely philosophical query, what is existence like for you? The problem, perhaps, is in the mundane routine of our daily existence, for we tend to overlook the fact that our most important task, no, better, our basic responsibility, is to be. Being, or ising, has many specifications. To be a good citizen, to be a good parent, to be a friendly neighbor, to be a responsible employer or employee, to be generous with our time and our goods, to be a loving spouse, to be helpful. So, when you hear the word being within these pages, please, after a brief wince, try to think all of the above. As many wisdom thinkers had observed, the good seeks to diffuse itself, but as their own experience taught, all they had to offer was their own experience. When seekers searched out those whose lives revealed a certain something, a quality variously named spirituality, sanctity, bliss, serenity, and earnestly asked, "What must I do?" they consistently received the only possible answer: "Come, follow me, see how I live." There was once a Sufi who lived alone. He was sought out by a young man who wanted enlightenment, and he allowed him to come and live nearby, and said and did nothing to discourage him. At length, having no teaching and little to think about, the young man said, "I have never seen you eating, and I marvel at how you sustain life without food." "Since you joined me," said the Sufi, "I have stopped eating in front of you. Now I eat in secret." The young man, even more intrigued, said, "But why should you do that? And if you wanted to deceive me, why do you now confess?" "I stopped eating," said the sage, "so that you might marvel at me, in the hope that you would one day stop marveling at irrelevancies and become a real student." The young man asked, "But could you not have simply told me not to marvel at superficialities?" "Everyone in the world," said the Sufi, "and that includes you, has already been told precisely that at least 100 times. Do you imagine that one more handful of words on this subject would have had any effect on you?" For what the spiritual masters, and we hope this book, offer is a retail spirituality. In this area, as in just about every other, there is always the whispering voice of someone who knows shortcuts or can get it for you wholesale. And as just about everyone who has ever fallen for such a scam knows, you get what you work for, what you pay for in whatever currency. And there is no such reality as discount spirituality. Stories invite thought and may indeed impose effort, even as they convey experience. Nothing trumps experience. It is not the aim of this book to teach, persuade, or convince. Rather, we hope to present, to those who are ready, realities that their experience might approach. And so, in Experiencing Spirituality, we continued to follow what we began in The Spirituality of Imperfection, telling stories of the spiritually adept, the stories that they told those who sought to follow them, the stories that were their lives, the stories that may help us answer the most meaningful question of all: how do we be? A note to the listener. It has been said that all wisdom is plagiarism. Only stupidity is original. Hugh T. Kerr. Even a passing glance within the pages of this book will lead to the discovery that many of the stories we tell are not new. Very true, but stories are usually presented within a context, so although the listener may have heard or read one or another of these stories before, this listening should be different. Stories do not just hang in space as discrete entities, they are rather embedded in a context. The context changes the meaning and the impact of the story. Also, although we have tried to keep this to a minimum, we do bring in bits and pieces of quotes and stories from the spirituality of imperfection. For these two books are deeply connected. As earlier then, we borrow from the past in order to enrich the present and future. We offer not so much new stories as new contexts in which to appreciate some stories that have withstood the test of time precisely because they have different meanings in different contexts. Please understand that although some of our stories may provoke a smile, we are not trying to be funny. Similarly, though some tales may lift your spirits, we are not attempting to be inspiring. We rather try to present here an invitation to a new way of seeing, at times by placing together ideas and images not usually witnessed in embrace. In this, we endeavor to follow in the footsteps of one of the great storytellers, Martin Buber. He wrote, "I stand in a chain of narrators, a link between links. I tell once again the old stories, and if they sound new, it is because the new already lay dormant in them when they were told for the first time." We also walk with Buber in that more than 15% of our stories have a Jewish, mainly Hasidic, context. This happens not by accident, but because of the richness of this tradition and the many joys of both our exposures to it. Although neither of us is Jewish, we each have had Jewish mentors and guides who introduced us to the wealth of that story tradition. We are grateful to them and to that tradition. A further word about the stories. Neither the stories nor their placement is haphazard. On many occasions, both will be obvious. At other times, the listener may puzzle, "Why this story here?" We respectfully suggest that the puzzled listener pause to ponder that question, for there will always be an answer, even if it is not the answer. Spirituality in none of its forms can be commanded. That is one core of its affinity with stories. We can grasp only if we reach. And while it is true that not every reach results in a sure grasp, it is even more true that we have been made to reach. Grasping is the gift of grace. What is that grace? Annie Lamott has come perhaps as close as anyone to describing it. She writes, "I do not at all understand the mystery of grace, only that it meets us where we are, but does not leave us where it found us." Each segment in Experiencing Spirituality is a discrete piece that can be heard out of order and savored out of context. When taken together, however, the segments form a whole, the whole of the experience of spirituality. Stories pose a special challenge. Most of the stories that we retell are, in one way or another, classic. They have been around for a long time, for so long a time, often in widely diverse places, that it is impossible accurately to source them with any confidence. In general, then, we offer attributions only for less familiar stories. The unattributed stories may readily be found in many places, in varying versions, in most cases, in more than one source, both online and printed. Online sources for the classic or common old chestnut stories may generally be found by searching for the story's punchline. In presenting these stories, we identify with storyteller Anthony DeMello, who more than once explained of his own use of them. "The stories in this book come from a variety of countries, cultures, and religions. They belong to the spiritual heritage and popular humor of the human race. All that the author has done is to string them together with a specific aim in mind. His task has been that of the weaver and the dyer. He takes no credit at all for the cotton and the thread." Thank you, and enjoy.
Beyond Spirituality. The problem with the term spirituality is that its meaning has been distorted for us by hearing the word used mainly in the phrase spiritual rather than religious. This connection has fogged up our idea, understanding, of spirituality, has led it to have an almost negative connotation, by in a very real way defining it by what it is not, because we all know what religion is. What has been lost is the reality that signifies some profound change in being. Marilyn Robinson. A Hasid burst into the study of Reb Yerachmiel ben Israel. "Rebbe," he said breathlessly, "what is the way to God?" The Rebbe looked up from his studies and answered, "There is no way to God, for God is not other than here and now." "Then, Rebbe, tell me the essence of God." "There is no essence of God, for God is all and nothing." "Then, Rebbe, tell me the secret that I might know that God is all." "My friend," Rebbe Yerachmiel sighed, "there is no way, there is no essence, there is no secret. The truth you seek is not hidden from you. You are hiding from it." Spirituality is stuck, not the reality, but its name. Or perhaps also, to some extent, the reality. Realities take on the qualities of the names in which we encase them. And so, as in the story, spirituality is not hidden, but its reality has become such that we too easily hide from it. That hiding is facilitated by a phrase that has become more popular than either of its conjoined terms, spiritual rather than religious. Most people do not seem to give much thought to what is spirituality, but they are certain of this one thing about it: it is not religion. One problem with nodding, knowing mainly what reality is not, is that the more we talk about it, the less we seem to know. It often helps to have a clear idea about what something is not, but when that is all we know about it, we really know nothing. It is difficult, perhaps impossible, to experience nothing. It is even more hopeless to attempt to communicate that experience. And so, how can we talk about some reality when the main thing we know about it is what it is not? A couple of generations ago, Episcopal preacher-turned-Zen teacher Alan Watts, frustrated by the apparent inability of the available theologies to grasp the nature of change, proclaimed that his, and our, task is to find a way of communicating that which cannot be spoken, or in his inimitable phrase, to F the ineffable, to speak that which cannot be put into words, and more. Stories, in a way, F the ineffable. They convey experience not by talking about, which never works, but by opening hearts and minds in ways that can make them capable of experiencing that which cannot be described. There are still limits. No words or story will ever convey the taste of chocolate ice cream or the scent of a rose. A story may, however, enable a trace of recognition of the meaningfulness of the welcoming smile of a lover. He opened his eyes and looked at her. She greeted him with a mocking, enigmatic smile in which was a poignant gaiety. Over his face went the reflection of the smile. He smiled too, purely unconsciously. That filled her with extraordinary delight, to see the smile across his face reflected from her face. She remembered that was how a baby smiled. It filled her with extraordinary, radiant delight. "You've done it," she said. "What?" he asked, dazed. "Convinced me." And she bent down, kissing him passionately, passionately, so that he was bewildered. He did not ask her of what he had convinced her, though he meant to. He was glad she was kissing him. She seemed to be feeling for his very heart to touch the quick of him, and he wanted her to touch the quick of his being. He wanted that most of all. D.H. Lawrence, Women in Love. If, as the traditions of primitive peoples seem to bear out, religion and spirituality began not in fear, but in awe and gratitude, an openness to such experience is the true beginning of any spirituality. But what does such openness mean? What does it involve? Imagine, picture, a hand, your hand. You use it in several ways each day. Much of the time, it is grasping something, a pen, a knife or fork, a book, the steering wheel of a car, the hand of another person. At other times, the hand is resting. Most of the time, when my hands are at rest, the palms tend to be held down or inward, fingers slightly flexed, relaxed. But there are also times when I hold out my hand palm up. On many such occasions, I am waiting or hoping to receive something, to have someone place something in my hand. Also, from habit or training, I am not sure which, my hands are held open, palms up, when I meditate. When I relax and let go and try to be open to reality as it is. Spirituality begins in such openness. Openness, most of the time, our human tendency is to want to grasp, to command, to bring about, to do. But when dealing with the spiritual, the attempt to control or manipulate makes that which we seek, that which we hope for, vanish. We might as well try to capture soap bubbles with a fork. Awe and control are impossible bedfellows. And yet, we can hope to influence without claiming to control. How readily and naturally, for example, when faced with some tragedy or sorrow, do we desire, yearn, to make it better? Surely there is nothing wrong with this longing that seems so deeply engraved in our very being. Spiritual traditions encourage not only the good work of helping others, but also prayer, and specifically prayers of petition, especially prayers for the good of others. We are made to want to help because in many ways we are made in order to help. That, the first deep lesson of spirituality suggests, is why we are here, on some level so profound that we most often experience it without being aware of it. We are made for each other. Time before time, when the world was young, two brothers shared a field and a mill. Each night they divided evenly the grain that they had ground together during the day. Now, as it happened, one of the brothers lived alone, the other had a wife and a large family. One day, the single brother thought to himself, "It isn't really fair that we divide the grain evenly. I have only myself to care for, but my brother has children to feed." So each night he secretly took some of his grain to his brother's granary to see that he was never without. But the married brother said to himself one day, "It isn't really fair that we divide the grain evenly, because I have children to provide for me in my old age, but my brother has no one. What will he do when he is old?" So every night he secretly took some of his grain to his brother's granary. As a result, both of them always found their supply of grain mysteriously replenished each morning. Then one night the brothers met each other halfway between their houses, suddenly realized what had been happening, and embraced each other in love. The story is that God witnessed their meeting and proclaimed, "This is a holy place, a place of love, and here it is that my temple shall be built." And so it was. The holy place, where God is made known, is the place where human beings discover each other in love. Non-spirituality is wrapped up in self as center of the universe. We all begin life in this way. It is part of the necessary baggage of infancy. Slowly, however, maturity should dawn, the maturity of the realization that self is not the center of the universe, that others are at least as worthy as we, that we truly fulfill ourselves only with and through others, and that we serve those others in the same way. An old creation myth story, sometimes told to children or adults on a religious retreat, describes the infinite God as from all eternity looking over the world and seeing the need for some particular, specific task to be done, some role to be filled. And so God forms the being who will do that task, who will fulfill that function, who will be that being. That is how and why each one of us is created. Each of us exists not only to do something that no other being can do, but even more to be that being that no other being can be. Each of us is unique, an individual like no other, and in this resides our dignity. In a very singular sense, in this story, the infinite God needs each one of us as we are. That is why we are here. The devotee knelt to be initiated into discipleship. The master whispered the sacred mantra into his ear, warning him to reveal it to no one. "What will happen if I do?" asked the devotee. Said the master, "Anyone to whom you reveal the mantra will be liberated from the bondage of ignorance and suffering, but you yourself will be excluded from discipleship and suffer damnation." No sooner had he heard these words than the devotee rushed to the marketplace, collected a large crowd, and repeated the sacred mantra for all to hear. The disciples reported this to the master and demanded that the man be expelled from the monastery for his disobedience. The master smiled and said, "He has no need of anything I can teach. His action has shown him to be a master in his own right." What complicates our stories is that one part of our dignity as human beings, our ability to do, tends to outrun our being. We love to manipulate, to bring about, to control, and we should do so, for again, that is one reason we are here. But our being is more important, and there are some realities, realities essential to our very being, that, as the forked soap bubble image reminds, we cannot control. Indeed, the effort, the demand, to control them destroys not only them, but ourselves. Spirituality is one of those realities. Yet, as is the case with love, another of those realities, its attractiveness and desirability, are so great that some claim not only to grasp them, but to make them available to others, for a price. But there are some realities, spiritual realities, that price destroys. As economist Joan Robinson observed a half century ago, bought sex is just not the same. The world of material things requires the kind of control that is commerce. One genius of civilization is to be found in the diverse ways in which commerce, the exchange of material things, has been developed and facilitated. But such commerce can be a treacherous form of control, and genuine spirituality eludes all attempts at control. Spirituality is not a possession. In fact, most often, those who have it don't seem to realize that they have it. A cobbler approached Rabbi Isaac of Gur, seeking advice. "Tell me," the cobbler asked with a heavy heart, "what shall I do about my morning prayers?" He went on to explain that his clients were poor men who had only one pair of shoes. He picked up the shoes late at night when the men returned from work, and then he worked all night to repair the shoes. But when dawn came around, there were still shoes left to be repaired, and so he often missed his morning prayers. "I don't know what to do," the cobbler said, his head bowed down in shame. "What have you been doing so far?" the rabbi asked. "Well, sometimes I rush through the prayers, which makes me feel bad," the cobbler admitted. "Other times I am so busy that I will let the hour of prayer go by, and at those times I feel even worse. Lifting my hammer, I can almost hear my heart sigh, realizing what an unfortunate man I am that I cannot find the time to say my morning prayers." "If I were God," the rabbi said, "I would value that sigh more than the prayer." Spiritual rather than religious. Theologians, social scientists, spiritual directors, poets, and novelists have commented richly on the problematic nature of that distinction. All who seriously examine the matter agree that spirituality is surely more than not religion. Spirituality, they all seem to say in one way or another, in some way involves an experience of beyond. It beyonds us. All observers agree that genuine spirituality begins by looking outside the self, beyond the subjective. If religion is founded, as Robert Bella suggests in his monumental study, Religion in Human Evolution, in awareness of an alternative reality, then spirituality involves a consciousness of contact with that alternative reality. In this sense, spirituality is beyond religion. Master Shaku Soen liked to take an evening stroll through a nearby village. One day he heard loud lamentations from a house and, on entering quietly, realized that the householder had died and the family and neighbors were crying. He sat down and cried with them. An old man noticed him and remarked, rather shaken on seeing the famous master crying with them, "I would have thought that you at least were beyond such things." "But it is this which puts me beyond it," replied the master with a sob. Genuine spirituality is beyond the spirituality of those who see it as only or mainly not religion. Stephen Bamber, British student of the role of spirituality in the healing of alcoholics and addicts, notes that too much of what passes as the new spirituality is celebrated by those who, disillusioned by traditional religions, view it as a force for wholeness, healing, and inner transformation that provides a liberation and solace in an otherwise meaningless world. While that may be a laudable goal, he remarks, too often something is also missing, lost. For this spirituality's focus is on self, and that too easily leads to forgetting or ignoring the reality of a higher, transcendent authority, a genuinely alternative reality. Noting that the practices of traditional religion and classic spirituality aim towards some transcendent reality and the softening of the boundaries of the self, Bamber goes on to point out that the goal of some contemporary so-called spiritualities appears to be the development of a more effectively defined self. Sadly, this does not work. For in reality, as several commentators have cautioned, genuine spirituality is not knowing what you want, but understanding what you do not need. The real tension, as psychotherapist and pastoral counselor Jeff Georgie points out in a similar context, is not between religion and spirituality, but between spirituality and materialism. Spirituality is the sensitivity to, the celebration of, and the participation in that which makes humans as a species special. Humans are not special because of things. We are literally made for more, but more not of material things or honors or degrees or workshops, but more in the sense of beyond. We are special because in our very ordinariness, we in some way transcend merely material reality. Things, most of us eventually learn, do not and cannot satisfy for long. Soon we become sated, bored, and begin to look for some other more. The same is true of a denatured spirituality that prioritizes self over transcendent reality. Like seed cast on rocky ground, such spring up rapidly only to as quickly die for lack of moisture and roots. Or perhaps a story from Southeast Asia captures more vibrantly and from a helpfully different angle what is actually going on here. During the early days of the Kingdom of Ava, a caravan of hillmen arrived with their merchandise at the marketplace. After selling their wares, they went from stall to stall with gold coins jingling in their pockets, looking for rare articles to be bought and taken home. They paused before a stall selling fruit and looked in wonder at a bunch of coconuts on display. "What are those?" asked the leader of the caravan. "Coconuts, my friend," replied the woman stallkeeper. "They are very expensive, and only kings and great lords can afford to buy them." "Of course I can afford to buy them," the caravan leader replied somewhat testily. "Name your price." Learning that the price was 1 silver coin for 1 coconut, he bought the whole bunch with a lordly air. The hillmen then started on their journey homeward, and after 1 or 2 days' travel, the caravan leader said, "My friends, let us now taste the wondrous coconut, which only kings and lords can eat." So saying, he cut the coconut, ate the outer fiber, and then threw away the nut, thinking it was a mere seed, and not dreaming at all that there was sweet milk and a rich kernel inside. His friends followed suit with the other coconuts from the bunch. The caravan leader then said, "Friends, kings and lords are foolish indeed to value this tasteless fruit." Life, reality, wisdom, call it what you will. Even spirituality throws curveballs. It is never exactly, or at times even nearly, what we expect. The deepest truths, the most profound realities, the sweet milk and rich kernel of a timeless spirituality, have a way of sneaking up on us, of being not quite what we anticipated, and so too casually we may throw them away. This may be the most profound wisdom that needs to be learned by those overly enamored of being in control. A rabbi once came to Reb Yerachmiel after a meditation workshop. A member of my congregation, a philosopher at the State College, asked me to teach him how to meditate. How should I instruct him? Reb Yerachmiel replied, "Teach him the prayer for moving his bowels, and teach him to recite it every time he does so. Don't let him read on the toilet. He must just sit and pray." On another occasion, During a presentation on spirituality, a woman rose and said, "I have no need of these practices. I feel spiritual all the time without doing anything." Reb Yerachmiel looked at her for a moment and said, "The next time you have an urge to be spiritual, take a cold shower. Then dry off and do something kind for someone else." As Reb Yerachmiel reminded in that same context, spirituality is no different than everyday life. It is doing everyday things with an attentive mind, which awakens us to the fact that we are both apart from and a part of everything else. Thus awakened, we discover simultaneously the reality of our emptiness and the reality of our connectedness. Reb Yerachmiel continues, "Spirituality is not a thing or a feeling. Spirituality is paying attention. Spirituality is being present to what is happening around and within you. Spirituality is living in the world with compassion and justice. Spirituality is making the world a little better for your having been born into it. Spirituality is meeting God in the ordinariness of our everyday lives." Spirituality, then, implies a profound awareness, but within this, spirituality is ordinary. The ordinary is never spectacular, in large part because it concerns not our doing, but our very being. Genuine spirituality looks not at its nose, nor in a mirror, but outside the self, beyond the immediate and the subjective. And that very looking beyond us conveys us away from the self-centeredness that is the human trap. Such spirituality asks, "Whom can I help today, and how can I be of service?" When a learned but miserly man asked Rabbi Abraham of Stretton for a drug to attain the fear of God, the rabbi offered him instead one for the love of God. "That's even better," cried the man. "Just give it to me." "It is the love of one's fellow men," replied Rabbi Abraham. As strange as the claim may sound, there is a God beyond spirituality. And the God beyond spirituality is a quirky God. One day, Muhammad was offering morning prayer, and among the crowd of people praying with the Prophet was an Arab aspirant. Muhammad began to read the Quran and recited the verse in which Pharaoh claims, "I am your true God." Hearing this, the aspirant was filled with spontaneous anger and shouted, "The boastful son of a bitch!" The Prophet said nothing. But after the prayer was over, others began to scold the Arab. "Aren't you ashamed of yourself? Your prayer displeases God because not only did you interrupt the holy silence of prayer, but you used filthy language in the presence of God's prophet." The poor Arab trembled with fear until the angel Gabriel appeared to the prophet and said, "God sends greetings to you and wishes you to get these people to stop scolding that simple Arab. Indeed, his spontaneous profanity moved my heart more than the holy prayers of the others." What then is spirituality? 20 years ago, we wrote, "The disciples were absorbed in a discussion of Lao Tzu's dictum, 'Those who know do not say. Those who say do not know.' When the master entered, they asked him what the words meant. Said the master, 'Which of you knows the fragrance of a rose?' All of them knew. Then he said, 'Put it into words.' All of them were silent." What is spirituality? To have the answer is to have misunderstood the question. Truth, wisdom, goodness, beauty, the fragrance of a rose, all resemble spirituality in that they are intangible, ineffable realities. We may know them, but we can never grasp them with our hands or with our words. These entities have neither color nor texture. They cannot be gauged in inches or ounces or degrees. They do not make a noise to be measured in decibels. They have no distinct feel, as do silk, wood, or cement. They give no odor. They have no taste. They occupy no space. And yet they exist. They are. Love exists. Evil exists. Beauty exists. And spirituality exists. These are the realities that have always been recognized as defining human existence. We do not define them, they define us. When we attempt to define spirituality, we discover not its limits, but our own. Similarly, we cannot prove such realities. It is truer to say that they prove us, in the sense that it is against them that we measure our human being, the act and the process by which we exist. Life is not what we have or even what we do, connected as these may be. We are what and how and who we are, and being is a real activity. Like love, spirituality is a way that we be. This way of being defies definition and delineation. We cannot tie it up, in any way package it or enclose it. Elusive in the sense that it cannot be pinned down, spirituality slips under and soars over efforts to capture it, to fence it in with words. Centuries of thought confirm that mere words can never induce the experience of spirituality. Thus began the spirituality of imperfection. Much has changed, yet little is different from the context into which we launched the spirituality of imperfection more than 2 decades ago. Spirituality remains impossible to define, but some brief, more recent descriptions may help frame understanding as we set out to explore it from the active perspective of experience. Jesuit retreat master Edward Kinnock suggests that the closest description of spirituality is lifestyle, continuing that any definition of spirituality should contain the idea of personal growth. What distinguishes the human condition is growth beyond self, self-transcendence. Edward Selner, a scholar of Celtic spirituality, proposes that spirituality in its broadest sense is, quite simply, a way of life that reveals an awareness of the sacred and a relationship with the Holy One in the midst of our human fragility, brokenness, and limitations. According to Benedictine monk Jerome Dollard, spirituality is a lot like health. It is not something we can go out and buy, although a lot of people have tried that. We all have health. We may have good health or poor health, but it's something we can't avoid having. The same is true of spirituality. Every human being is a spiritual being. The question is whether the spirituality we have is the negative one that leads to isolation and self-destruction, or the one that is more positive and life-giving. And although not using the term spirituality, D.H. Lawrence observed that, however smart we may be, however rich and clever or loving or charitable or spiritual or impeccable, it doesn't help us at all. The real power comes into us from the beyond. Life enters us from behind, where we are sightless, and from below, where we do not understand. And unless we yield to the beyond and take our power and might and honor and glory from the unseen, from the unknown, we shall continue empty. Finally, Sandra Marie Schneiders, perhaps our most profound contemporary student of the relationships between spirituality and religion, suggests that spirituality, like personality, is a characteristic of the human being as such. It is the capacity of persons to transcend themselves through knowledge and love, that is, to reach beyond themselves in relationship to others and thus become more than self-enclosed material monads. In how many ways is it possible to say spirituality is simple, ordinary? Perhaps we need to return to an adventure of childhood when we may have asked about spirituality or grace or some other term we heard in a place of worship. If we were fortunate, our parents or other teachers told us to watch the wind. It is obviously real, but you cannot see it, only its effects. Later we learned that air is a kind of fluid, and the wind is like waves we could make in the water. But let's get desophisticated for a moment and think again of the wind as wind. We do not see wind as it is, but we see and feel what it does. And that's the way it is with spirituality. As Albert Einstein is said to have observed, not everything that counts can be counted. And so, what is spirituality? Spirituality is to be found in the ordinary and everyday phenomena and activities of being described in the following segments. Spirituality is experienced in our listening, in our forgiveness, in our dark places, in our confusions, in our stories. Not so much in what we do, but in what and how we be, by how we experience the realities that we meet. Spirituality is, in briefest description, a way of life, a way of being. For like life and love, spirituality is a way that we be. This way of being defies definition and delineation. We cannot tie it up, in any way package it or enclose it. Elusive in the sense that it cannot be pinned down, spirituality slips under and soars over all efforts to capture it, to fence it in with words. But because it is experienced, spirituality can be described. What is spirituality? I recently heard a story of someone asking a monk, "What is your life like as a monk?" The monk replied, "We walk, we fall down, someone helps us up. We walk some more, someone else falls down, we help them up. That's pretty much what we do."
Experience. There is no desire more natural than that of knowledge. We try all ways that can lead us to it. Where reason is wanting, we therein employ experience. Michel de Montaigne. Spirituality denotes experience, a term that is itself very difficult to define. It implies that spirituality is not an abstract idea, a theory, an ideology, or a movement of some kind. It is personal, lived reality. Sandra Marie Schneiders. Once some of the elders were in seat, and Abbot John the Dwarf was with them. While they were dining, a priest, a very old man, attempted to serve them. But no one would take so much as a cup of water from him, except John the Dwarf. The others were shocked by this, and later said to him, "How is it that you consider yourself worthy to accept service from that holy man?" He replied, "When I offer people a drink of water, I am happy if they take it. Did you expect me to sadden the good man by depriving him of the joy of giving me something?" Experience is both noun, something that is, and verb, something one does. What an experience! Well, you will just have to experience that for yourself. Now that was an experience. In how many ways do we experience experience? To experience is to go through or endure something. An experience is not encountered. It is lived through. Duration is essential. That is why we need story to convey experience. Experiencing something means that some reality is seen, heard, and more. One's whole being is involved, somehow touched, and insofar as possible, brought into the experience. A cowboy was riding across the desert when he came upon an Indian lying on the road, with his head and ear to the ground. "How you doing, chief?" said the cowboy. "Big pale face with red hair driving dark green Mercedes with German shepherd dog inside and license plate number SDT965 going west." "Gee, chief, you mean you hear all that just by listening to the ground?" "I'm not listening to the ground. The SOB ran over me."
One of the oft-quoted sayings of John Colobos, the John the Dwarf, whose story opens this segment, ran, "Unawareness is the root of all evil." But how does one achieve awareness? In conversation? By watching for it? By thinking about it? Where reason is wanting, we therein employ experience. But is experience created or undergone? Is it possible to have enough experience? And what is the relationship between thought and experience? We will address these questions throughout this segment, throughout this book. Here, it is helpful to note that students of religious experience emphasize how many groups involve newcomers in experience, in participation prior to a detailed exposure to the tradition's belief system, a practice that takes advantage of the modern adage, "Act yourself into a new way of thinking," as well as recapturing a too often neglected classic insight. As stories convey, both acting and thinking are experiences,
and both experiences are involved in storytelling. There is a kind of circularity between experience and storytelling. According to Carol Christ in her rich study, Diving Deep and Surfacing, Women Writers on Spiritual Quest, stories give shape to experience, experience gives rise to stories. And as William James observed and lived out in his own life, my experience is what I agree to attend to. A famous Viennese surgeon told his students that a surgeon needed two gifts, freedom from nausea and the power of observation. He then dipped a finger into some disgusting fluid and licked it, asking each student to do the same. They steeled themselves and succeeded without flinching. Smiling, the surgeon announced, "I congratulate all of you on passing the first test, but not, I'm afraid, the second. Not one of you noticed that the finger I licked was not the one I dipped in the fluid." There are two terms that, while their processes surely are included in experience.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.